So you want to design the equalizer, and what is the length of the equalizer? You have G0, G1 and G-1. You have to choose one of them to be fixed, right? Let's say first you choose G0 to be 1, just arbitrarily. Then in the equalized channel, your cursor will be G0 H0 plus G, this whole thing. So you will get some particular value of the cursor. And secondly, you can choose G0 such that the cursor in the equalized channel is 1. It's not G0 H0, but the main tap, whatever that is 1. Yeah, it's not G0 H0, it's G0 H0 plus G-1 H1 plus... Yeah.
And the other is when you minimizing with respect to the other two values like G1 and G1.
No, but what are you minimizing? You are minimizing the ISI tabs, right?
Yeah, minimizing the ISI.
Okay, I'll just give you. So let's say you choose G0 equal to 1, and then you choose some other G0, G0 equal to 2. Okay? So, and in each of these cases, you calculate G-1 and G1, such that the mean square of all the other tabs is the minimum. So you do it in this case and you also do it in this case. What will be the difference? It will just be the twice of this. It will just be a scaled version of the same thing. I don't think you will get anything different. Maybe you will go through a little more algebra, but however you calculate G0, to minimize, what you are minimizing is, in this case you will have something like this. You are minimizing the sum of squared of these things. So there is only one particular solution to that, and actually the degrees of freedom you have are G-1 by G0 and G1 by G0. It doesn't depend on the absolute value of G0. Okay, let me do this. Let me take G0 equal to 1 to start with. Okay, from that I get some cursor value, and I get what is the cursor value? I get G0 H0 plus G-1 H1 plus G1 H-1. Okay, this will be the cursor value I get with G0 equal to 1. Let's say this is some F0. Then I divide all the tabs by F0. So my equalizer will be G-1 by F0, G0 by F0 and G1 by F0. So that will give you the cursor in the equalized channel to be 1 and the rest of it is minimized. So it won't make any difference. Meaning, I think you should get the same answer. If you get it differently, let me know. Is it? But somehow I think it should be exactly the same, because it's just a matter of scaling. But what are you doing with the mean square?
The mean square I minimize with respect to G-1 and G1.
Yeah, minimize what? These things, right?
Minimize the mean square of this thing.
Square of the things other than the cursor.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. Then I think it should not make any. Oh, okay.
And take a and put that like the whole motion equation and the same equation. The whole value at the
But what did you do with G-1?
G-1 value I took from the whole cursor equals to 1. One condition I am getting all this from there. I minimize with respect to any other two variables.
So even this I think should give you the same answer. But we can discuss it. Like what is the order of the difference? No, no, but do you get the same equalizer tabs, that is in the same ratio? You do. I mean, so in one case you get G0, G-1 and, sorry, G-1 and G1. In the other case you will get this time some alpha. The ratio of precursor and postcursor to the cursor should be the same. If that's not the same, I think we'll see. Okay? Can you just check that and let me know? It's not coming? Yeah, that's true. Actually, in absence of noise, it won't be. I think what I should have asked you to do is to plot the frequency response. That will probably be different. Yeah, even that is a little bit different, but not too much, I think. Yeah. Yeah. But I think if you plot the frequency response, I expect the 046 to do something like this and the minimum mean square error to not emphasize it as much. Okay. So if you plot the frequency response, you will see. Maybe I'll just make it part of the next assignment. Any other questions? Yesterday we were looking at how to make equalizers on the transmit side, how to make the transmit side equalizer, and the transmit equalizer was easier because we are handling digital data. We know how to make ideal delays for digital inputs, that is using flip flops. Okay, because the inputs to the FIR filter are digital, you can use flip flops to delay the data. So what we wanted to do was something like this. If you want three taps, or rather if you want four taps, you use four flip flops and form a weighted summation of the flip flop outputs, and by adjusting these weights you can get the equalizer taps to whatever you want, and all these flip flops are clocked from the same clock. And this could, for instance, be an equalizer with two post-cursor taps and one precursor tap. Is everyone convinced that this forms an equalizer for the input data? Okay. Yesterday we were trying to work out how to realize this weighted summation, and the answer you remember from your basic courses is to use an op-amp. Did you work out the specs of the op-amp? 23 gigahertz. Yeah. Gigahertz or gigaradians per second? Okay. So one way to do this is to use an op-amp in feedback and as many input resistors as there are inputs. And to get these weights, the input conductances must be weighted by the corresponding weights. So this is H-1, H0, H1, H2. Let me call this V-1, V0, V1. This is Vout. So this is H-1 times G. Okay. So you can just see that the weights are H-1, H0, H1 and H2. Let's assume that the op-amp behaves like an ideal integrator with a unity gain frequency omega u. Then the step response of something like this can be calculated from this circuit. And this effective conductance here is the sum of all these conductances when all the inputs are tied to zero. That is the effective conductance that we have. And we said that each of this H-1 was what? 0.25, right? And H0 was 1, H1 was half, plus 0.25 times G, which is basically 2G. Okay. So this conductance is 2G, and the transfer function of the op-amp is omega U by S. What is the loop gain? What is the loop gain? Loop gain is the transfer function of the op-amp times the ratio of the feedback, omega U by 3S. Omega U by 3S, right? One third. So you have a resistance R by 2 here and R here. So if you have a voltage at the output, one third of that appears at the input. Loop gain is omega U by 3S. So, I'm not going through the detailed analysis. So you know that the response of a circuit like that will have e to the minus omega u by 3s, omega u by 3 times t in it. And we also said that in one cycle there should be 99% settling. So we want e to the minus omega u by 3 times ts to be 0.01. So roughly speaking, omega U times 3 times Ts should be what? 5. So omega U should be 15 Fs. So Fs is in hertz and omega U is in gigaradians per second. So it's about 15 gigaradians per second for Fs equal to 1 gigabits per second or 1 gigahertz. Okay. So if it has to settle to 1% within 1 nanosecond, the gain bandwidth of the op-amp has to be 15 gigaradians per second, which is a ridiculously high number. You can't really, it's very hard to realize something like this. So something like this is out. What else can we do? we want to get weighted summation. I mean, when I say something like this is out, basically feedback circuits are out because it will have such a limitation. Okay. If you want to operate a feedback circuit at some frequency, then the loop gain has to be very high at that frequency, right? That's when you get accurate feedback. The idea behind feedback is you use negative feedback to minimize the error between the desired function and what you get. And that happens because of the large gain inside the loop. So if you want at 1 gigahertz, you want a nice transfer function, then at 1 gigahertz the loop gain should be very high. That's one way to think about feedback circuits. So that means that the unity gain frequency of the feedback network, the unity loop gain frequency has to be very high, much more than 1 gigahertz. So, and we really cannot make such very high frequency circuits and put them in feedback loop. So what do we have to do? What can we do? What else can we do to make the, yeah, it has to be an open loop circuit. So how can we realize weighted summation with open loop circuits? Yeah, one way to do it is, I mean, when you want to sum signals, it's easiest to sum currents. So you convert the voltages to currents, sum them by connecting them all to the same node and convert it back to voltage if necessary. Feedback circuits are difficult to make at high frequencies, so we use open loop circuits. Of course, if you happen to make an equalizer at low frequency, you can certainly use feedback circuits. Okay. We are generally assuming that it's at high frequencies that we need equalization, so it's at high frequencies that we make these equalizers. But maybe you come across a situation where you want to make an equalizer for low frequencies where you can use op-amps, then you can certainly use the op-amp circuit. So what do we do here? For simplicity, I'll reduce the number of taps to 3 and I convert each of these voltages to currents using a transconductor. And these GMs are not the same, so let me call this GM1, GM2 and GM3. What is the voltage I see here? If these are V1, V2 and V3. So, it's just the sum of currents times RL. The voltage that I say is GM1 V1, GM2 V2 plus GM3 V3 times RL. And this is typically how we end up making it. We can use different kinds of circuits for the transconductor itself, but this is generally how we make it. Okay. Now, what kind of data are V2, V1, V2, V3? They are also digital data, right? So we don't have to make a linear transconductor here. Let's say V1 has two levels, then this GM1 is V1 times GM1. So you can either use a linear transconductor or essentially you need some circuit that gives you two levels of current. Okay? Because the input itself is digital. You're only interested in two values. So this does not have to be linear if it's only two values. So you can use transconductors that are worse than what you guys perhaps studied in active filter design. There you need linearity. Here you are again, because you are operating with binary input data, the output to a binary input data should be two current levels. One corresponding to the low logic level, the other one corresponding to the high logic level. So if you have only two points, they are always in a straight line, right? So any circuit you have is linear as far as those two levels are concerned. So this, we use weighted summation using transconductors and the input is binary data, so the transconductors don't have to be linear. Are you all convinced of this fact that it doesn't have to be linear, right? You need a certain current for plus one input level and certain other current for a minus one input level. It doesn't have to be linear for all the values in between. Yeah, that's perfectly valid. So it doesn't matter, right? You have to get two values of current, whether you get it from a saturated case or a non-saturated case, it doesn't matter. Now, how do we realize these GMs? Yeah, so we can use differential pairs. So let's imagine a scenario like this. You have a differential transmission line, that is, it has two input wires and two output wires. And it is terminated on both sides. It should be terminated on both sides. So to terminate it on both sides, you can either drive them with voltage sources like this. So we are considering differential transmission. So this is V and minus V, this is R, this is also R and R. Okay, we have not gone into details of the transmission line, but you do know that if it is terminated by its characteristic impedance on both sides, you will not have reflections. So this transmission line represents the channel, whether it's a length of cable or a length of PCB trays. So this is one way to drive it. So another way to drive it would be with a current source, meaning you form the Norton equivalent of this voltage source and the resistance, and you have a certain current source I and the opposite current source minus I. So both are exactly equivalent, right? As far as network theory is concerned, the two are equivalent. Which one would be preferred? Is there some reason to choose between the two of these? So in this case, you have a voltage source and you drive a transmission line through a series resistance. In this case, you have a current source and you drive the transmission line and there is a shunt resistance. Is there some reason to choose between these two? The second one can be easily realized with a transistor because you can make current sources more easily. Okay, that's one reason. What else is the difference between the two? Supply noise will be lower. Why is that? I don't know. I mean, if you manage to realize a voltage source that's immune to supply noise, yeah, that may be the case, but you can't universally say that's true. You can make voltage sources which are not susceptible to supply noise. Voltage at the input of the transmission line? V by 2. Oh, yeah. So, this is V by 2. This is minus V by 2 in steady state. Okay. But that's the same here also, right? So, here also it is V by 2 minus V by 2. So, what's the difference? So, the transmitted signal is V differentially, okay? The transmitted voltage differentially across the transmission line is V. That is the same in both cases. But what is the difference? Actually, there is a difference related to the voltage. What is the maximum voltage you see in the two circuits? If there is what? Yeah. No, these two networks are exactly the same, right? If you have this I to be equal to that V by R, the voltages at any point on the transmission line will be the same in the two cases. They cannot be any. Yeah, that is the difference. See, there is no difference at all, right? Because the two networks are just the representations of each other. I can think of the second one as having converted the voltage source and the resistance to Norton. That should not change anything in the circuit. Okay? So, it will not change how the signal travels down the transmission line or anything. So, with or without attenuation, the two circuits are the same as far as network theory is concerned. The difference comes because here, the transmitted voltage is V differentially, or V by 2 and minus V by 2. So in this case, in the second case, there is no node in the circuit which has a voltage more than V by 2. Okay? Whereas in the first case, you have V and minus V at these nodes. So that means that somewhere in the circuit, you have to accommodate double the voltage. Now the supply voltages are already becoming smaller and smaller in integrated circuits. So it gets harder and harder to accommodate a larger voltage. Okay? Firstly, there is a difficulty of realizing voltage sources. It's much easier to realize current sources than to realize voltage sources. The other point here is, you have to accommodate a larger voltage if you drive with a voltage source, or you have to accommodate a larger current if you drive with a current source. Meaning, in this case, the current that you supply, half of it goes to the load and half of it is in the source. Okay? And in the first case, half of the voltage is in the source and half of it goes to the load. So in one case you lose voltage, in the other case you lose current. But, so there is no difference in the total power that you transmit. But the largest voltage that you have to accommodate with the voltage drive is much more, it's twice as much as the largest voltage in the current drive. That makes a huge difference, especially because your voltage ranges are shrinking continuously. Okay. Current drive is preferable because firstly, it's easier to make current sources than voltage sources. and also largest voltage with voltage drive is 2 times the largest voltage with current drive. So generally we prefer to drive it with the current, and anyway the structure that we came up with also does something like this. So if you look at the circuit that we have, it adds currents. So you can think of this part of the circuit as the current source, okay, that feeds currents into this load resistance. So you can make the circuit and drive this point with it, and if you want differential, the GMs have to be differential. So let's say we want to drive a differential transmission line. What we do is each of these GMs is differential, and the flip-flops are also likely to be differential at high frequencies. I have just shown them as single-ended lines, signals. Maybe each signal is represented by 2 wires. So we connect all of the GMs in parallel. We have the source side termination. This goes through the transmission line, and you have the load side termination. So this is now an exact representation of this circuit, where I is weighted summation of V1, V2 and V3. So let's imagine that we have differential flip-flops, perhaps what you designed in the first assignment, and we want to make this equalizer. What can we use for these transconductors? How do we make these transconductors? How do we realize the transconductor? You can use a differential pair. Differential pair gives you output current as a function of input voltage, and that can be used in place of this. So I'll just show the differential pair part. So if I have 3 taps, I need to have 3 differential pairs, and let me connect them up like this, and I'll have the current sources. And the characteristic of each differential pair with respect to its differential voltage, let's just make all this V0 here. So if I plot this I0A and I0B with respect to V0, I see something like this, where the maximum value is the tail current. So because V0 is binary data, we can choose to operate this in saturation region. So let's say the levels of V0 are somewhere here and here, that is, this corresponds to +1, this corresponds to -1. So in that case, all of I0 will be switched to one side. If the input is +1, it will be switched to the other side if the input is -1. So this is all that we want. Basically we need a switch current source. We call it a transconductor in general, but it's a switched current source because the input is binary. That's a limiting mode, basically where the current is saturated. So that's all that's there to design of equalizers, if you want to do it in the transmitter. So let's say I have 3 flip-flops, and I have voltages V0, V1 and V-1. I have changed the notation a little bit to make it correspond to the equalizer taps. V0 is the cursor, V-1 is the precursor, and V1 is the post cursor. Okay, so let's say V0 is connected like this. I am showing single-ended signals here, but it's assumed that these are differential flip-flops and both the clock and data are differential. So if V0 is connected like this, how would I connect V1 and V2? I mean V-1 and V1 for a general equalizer. What will be the polarity? Will it be this or the opposite? Opposite, because the precursor and the post cursor taps are likely to be negative. If you want they will be negative if you want a high pass response. So you have to have opposite polarity for them. And if I need more taps, I can connect more differential pairs to it. Is this clear? Any questions on this? And I assume you already know how to design a differential pair. If you have a certain input level, certain voltage levels corresponding to +1 and -1, you have to size these. You have to choose the W by L so that it switches completely for that particular value of input voltage, and that depends on the tail current that you have and the W by L. So you choose the W by L to be large enough. So is there some limit to the number of taps I can connect, or can I go on connecting? So what happens is all of these currents add. The signal currents will subtract from the main tap, but all of the tail currents will add. This is, let's say, I-1 and this is I1. So the total current flowing through this is, in the quiescent condition, that is assuming V-1, V0 and V1 to be 0, and the output common mode voltage is VDD minus I0 plus I1 plus I minus 1 R by 2. Okay. Now as you keep on increasing the number of taps, this part keeps on increasing. So the common mode voltage keeps dropping. So there is a limit to what you can realize. There is a limit to the number of taps that you can have. And how will you choose I0, I minus 1 and I1? Actually, we started off by saying that the weighted summation is because of the transconductance. That was a reasonable representation, but here we are not using it in the linear mode. So the transconductance model is not valid. So the tap weight is set by the tail current. Okay. So I minus 1 and I0 and I1 should be selected based on the tap weights that you want. So the transmit linear equalizer, it consists of a chain of flip flops to delay the signal and differential pairs to convert the voltage to current and to sum them up. For each tap you have a differential pair, and the tap weights are set by the tail currents. How would I vary the tap weights? Let's say I have an equalizer and I want to program the tap weights to different values. How will I do that? I'm not trying to figure out how to get the tap weight value. I'm saying, like, I have the circuit, how do I go and vary the tap weights? Change the tail current. So I have to change these, right? I have to change these currents to change the tap weight. But how do I go about doing it? Fix GM bias. How will that help? No, whatever it is, I want to be able to vary. Like, wherever I get the current source from, I want to be able to vary the tap value. So let's say, I mean, you have already done this assignment. So you know that in one case you need 2 taps and you need in another case maybe you need 4 taps. So let's say you make a 4 tap equalizer, but when you see the more benign channel, you just turn off 2 taps. That is one possibility. And you have something in the middle, then you reduce the value of those taps. So let's say I have a 3 tap equalizer. The cursor for now I'll fix at 1, and both the precursor and post cursor taps I want to vary from 0 to minus 0.5. So maybe I am using it without a channel, or maybe I am using it with a channel which has a broadband response, so I don't need equalization. In that case I set it to 0. What happens if I don't have a channel, or I don't have a broadband channel and I do equalization? What will happen? So I have the transmit equalizer turned on, but this channel happens to have no band limitation. The channel has no ISI. So what will happen to the output? It will have inter-symbol interference, that's all, because of the equalizer. So because of the equalizer, you will have inter-symbol interference. So you can't have equalizer turned on all the time. Is this clear? If you don't have inter-symbol interference in the channel, but you make an equalizer, that's like making another filter, right? So your output will have inter-symbol interference depending on the precursor and post-cursor taps. So you don't want to have it on all the time. So you want to be able to control the amount of equalization that you do. And I'll also make it more concrete. Let's say I want to do this in 4 steps. I want to be able to do this in steps of 0.125. Okay? I say that's good enough. That is, the whole thing is negative. So basically this says that I have to set each of these precursor and postcursor taps to either 0 or 0.125 or 0.25, 0.375, 0.5, any of those values. And one suggestion is, so what do you want to do? So I have 4 things in parallel. Okay, and where do I connect these gates to? So let me draw the other one also. Let me draw the cursor tap. In this case the current is fixed. And let's say this comes from some current mirror. And this has an aspect ratio of W0 by L0. And similarly I also have the post cursor tap which I am not showing. So where do I connect these gates to? And where will I connect the other side? I mean, switch between what and what? Yeah, that's correct. So if you wanted to have a fixed current source, you would have done this. Now you want a variable current source. So you want to either connect the gate to this point or to ground, depending on whether you want zero current or that amount of current from the transistor. So one way to do this, you have 2 switches. So this connects to ground. Okay. And these are controlled by complementary inputs. That is, if this switch is on, this is off, and so on. Okay. So then the gate of each transistor is either connected to the gate of this reference diode connected transistor all to ground. If it is connected to ground, it provides zero current. If it is connected to this branch, it provides some amount of current that you set by the aspect ratio and the reference current. Okay. So this way you can switch the value of the coefficient. Think about other ways in which you can switch the value of the coefficient. Okay, one thing he is bringing up is that as you change the tail current, the amount of voltage you need at the input to switch the current to fully to one side is different. So he says you can't just switch the tail transistor, you have to switch the entire differential pair. So that is true. If you design it for the highest current, it will switch for lower currents also. Okay. So that is typically what is done. But the other way also works if you try to duplicate the whole thing. So anyway, let's discuss it tomorrow. Yeah.